Amen. God bless you. Thank you, Jesus. God is good. Turn in your Bible to the book of John 4 and 23. Just pray. The book of John 4 and 23. And when you guys say amen, if me and God say hold up, the book of John 4 and 23. The book of John 4 and 23. Amen. The book of John 4 and 23. It says, "But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father is seeking those who will worship him." And then it says, "God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth." It says, the time has come. The time has come for those who are true worshipers to worship God. This is a time unlike any other time ever in the history of mankind. Never in the history of this country have churches been closed. Never in the history of this country have schools been closed. Never in the history of this country has the movie industry been shut down. It says, the time is coming when God is calling true worshipers. And it looks like this is the time. Because we're seeing things happen that has never, ever, ever happened before in the history of this country. What's interesting, we had World War II, and the Japanese had bombed Hawaii, which is Pearl Harbor. They didn't shut down the thing. They didn't close those schools. They didn't shut down nothing. Everything just kept going just like normal. But we see here that things are happening that have never, ever happened before. And the Bible says this. I'm going to read it again. "But the hour cometh, and now is, when true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For God is looking for those who will worship him." God is looking for those who will worship him. God doesn't like people who run when stuff is happening. He's looking for true worshipers who won't run when things get hot. It's like if you have a friend, and I remember growing up, I remember one time we was walking through the mall, and there was a group of other guys, and the guys were looking at my group, and then something popped off. Well, my friends didn't run and leave me. We all stood and fought together. God is looking for people who are not going to run when the fight comes to them. God says, I'm looking for true worshipers who will stand in the face of the enemy when Satan comes to test you. He's calling a new church. It's interesting. The old church is now falling away. The old churches are closed, and the old Christians and all the people who spoke in tongues and did all those marvelous praise dances, they ain't dancing no more. Faithful Central ain't been open in 10 months. The City of Refuge ain't been open in 10 months. All these big houses are closed. But it's the little churches that are standing. And this church, which is a young church, is standing while the old churches are closed and locked away. Give yourself a hand clap for standing when God has called. Imagine if we would close our doors and went away. God is calling a new church. He's calling true worshipers who will stand in the face of the enemy. You will be the ones who will stand the test of time. You will be the ones that they're talking about in heaven, because they're talking about you, because you're standing when everybody else is kneeling down or running away. The angels are shouting your name, and they're shouting Shaddai. They're shouting Shaddai. And I praise this young lady because she came in a time of pain. Give her a hand clap. Hallelujah. I don't care about 55 years from now. We're going to give you praise for coming and standing on faith. You guys are standing on faith, and that's amazing. There are people all over the world that pray for you, because this is a young church. There ain't a soul in here over 25, over 24, over 23. It's all young people who come to give God some praise. Amen. So God is looking for true worshipers. True worshipers. And he says that worship him in spirit and in in truth. Worship him in spirit and in truth. Spirit. What is spirit? Spirit. Spirit is energy. God says he's looking for people that's going to give him some energy. You guys give God energy. When you sang over here, you were singing with energy. Your energy brought you here tonight. It's the energy that God's going to look at to determine what's going on. We're going to talk about that a little later on. So, in 2021, it's time to renew our minds when it comes to our relationships with God. In 2021, it's time to renew our minds because God will be looking at our spirits. Turn with me to Psalm 75. And we're going to go to verse 6. God will be looking at our spirits. Amen. For he is the judge. Amen. Psalm 75. Go down to verse 6. It says, for promotion cometh neither from the east, nor from the west, nor from the south, nor from the north. But God is the judge. He putteth down one, and he setteth up another. It says that God is the judge. Everything that happens in your life is determined by God. Satan wants to kill you, but he can't touch you unless he gets permission from God. All the bad things that happen in your life happen because Satan got permission from God. And that's an interesting thing. You're like, why would God allow these bad things to happen to me? It's interesting. And we talked about Sister Oprah Winfrey, who was raped a few times, who was molested a few times, who was called fat and black and ugly and fat and black and ugly. Why would God allow that to happen to her? Because some of the things that you're going through in life, God has put it in your pathway to test you, to strengthen you, to prosper you, to test you, because he wanted to make you stronger. Remember, a diamond is nothing but a rock. A gold starts off as a rock. And the only way that a diamond gets to shine is it's tested. It goes through the fire, it goes through the testing, and after it goes through the testing, it comes out shining. Some of the things that you're going through in life, God allowed to happen in your life so that you could pass the test, so that you could come to the next level. Because when you have life too easy, you won't appreciate it. If everything was given to you, you wouldn't appreciate it. If they just get Compton High football players, and God bless them, matter of fact, give them a hand clap. I mean, they had to fight through it. Give them a hand clap. I don't care about y'all Dominican people. Amen. I used to watch them play. Peanut running with no line. Y'all don't know what the line is, but they're supposed to be guys out in front supposed to protect him. But he would run. He ought to be there by himself. John be out there running, 12 people chasing right behind him. I don't know how 12 got on the field, but it looked like 12. But they never quit. They could have walked away. Each and every one. You could have went to Matter Day. You could have went to Poly. You could have went to, what's that school over there in Inglewood? You could have went to any school, but you stayed at Compton. And I appreciate that because you stayed loyal. You stayed dedicated. And that's what God is looking for. He's looking for soldiers who's not going to run to the other side. It's because the other side looks a little better. He's looking for those who will be committed. Because coming up in this thing that's coming now, you're going to have to be committed to Christ. Because if you're not committed to him, you're going to have to go to the other side. We'll talk about that a little later. So God is looking for people who will be dedicated and who will do what he's called them to do. Next, turn me to Matthew 6 and 33. And I encourage you, please read your Bibles every day. Please read your Bibles every day. All right, Matthew 6 and 33 says this. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. All right, we're about to get to the deep side. The Bible says, seek God first, and whatever you want will be added unto you. Seek God first, and whatever you want will be added unto you. A lot of, and you guys are young, so it's okay. You dream of houses, and you dream of cars, and you dream of college degrees, and some of you dream of marriages, and some of you dream of children. The Bible says, seek God first. And it says, if you put God first, whatever you want will be added unto you. Here's something that's powerful. If you're not getting what you want from God, it's because you haven't put God first. What do you think about that? Whatever you're not getting is because you're not doing something. If you put God first, the Word says He'll give you everything that you ask for that won't kill you, because some of the things that you ask for ain't no good for you. But if you put God first, He would add unto you everything that you want and everything that you need. The problem with us is we don't put God first in our lives. We put jobs first. Some girls put boyfriends first. Some guys put girlfriends first. We put everything before God. We put partying before God. We put all kinds of things before God. And then when we don't get what we want, well, why did God do this for me? Because He knows He's not number one on your list. And our God is a jealous God. Well, why is God jealous? Because He made you. He's the author, the creator. He's the finisher. He created you. He tapped you and woke you up this morning. The reason why you ain't dead now is because He protected you. He has the right to be a jealous God. He has the right to say, put me first. And when I was growing up, I didn't understand that until I got older and I became a father. Because once you become a leader, you understand what responsibility is. See, right now you're young and most of y'all live in a house and somebody paid for the lights, and they paid for the Wi-Fi, and they paid for the food, and they paid for everything. It's Christmas time and you look under the tree, there's a whole bunch of gifts there. You're like, yay. But once you become responsible, you understand what it takes. And God says, I'm responsible for everything that you see. I'm responsible for your very heartbeat. I'm responsible for every process that you can imagine, because He is God. If we put Him first, He'll put you first. I want you to hear that. If you put God first, He'll put you first. Well, what does it look like to put God first? I'm glad you asked that. To put God first, number one, read the Word. Read the Word. How many of you read your Bible today? Nah, I'm going to raise my hand. Give yourself a hand clap. Hallelujah. Amen. God bless you. Read your Bibles every day. Read your Bibles every day. In Psalms 119, 105, it says, Thy word is a lamp unto our feet. God's word is light. It gives us light. See, we're surrounded by darkness. What's the thing called? YouTube darkness. What's the other thing? Hulu, darkness. ABC, CNN, darkness. Hip hop, darkness. It's darkness all around you. Well, why you calling those things dark? I'm calling them dark because they feed you lies. They tell you things that aren't true. They tell you that you can sell drugs for 50 years and retire and go into an island and live by yourself. They tell you you can go shoot 85 people and nothing happens to you. They tell you you can have sex with a whole lot of women and not get a disease or not make 25 babies. It tells you all kinds of things that aren't true. But we listen to it. We bob our head. Hey, what's that new song, Poppy? What's that new song by Baby Style? What is it? Wada, wada, wada. What is it called? Body, 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 body. Yeah, we bodying everybody. We just bodying everything. And next thing you know, you're pregnant. It ain't so funny now. But you catching all these bodies, and one of these bodies now stuck in you. It becomes a reality check. The reality is that sin costs. Every sin has a price. But we listen to this music and we turn on this TV and we buy into things that are lies. So that's why we have to read the Word of God. Because you need some truth in your life. If you want to prosper and in progress, you can't live and abide by lies. Because the lies will lead you to a place of sinking sand. And what is sinking sand? Destruction.
Sinking sand has been stuck in the same place for 25 years and going nowhere. Sinking sand is not prospering. Sinking sand is being distressed. Sinking sand is not having what you want in life. Imagine if you are 50 years old, you make the same amount of money you make now. I know 50-year-olds who still live with their parents. You don't want that for your future. And it didn't happen by accident. It happened because they were fed lies and they believed Satan. You can't believe the words of Satan because Satan is a liar. Amen. Turn me to Mark 10 and 13. Mark 10 and 13. We're almost done. Mark 10 and 13. Mark 10 and 13. Mark 10 and 13. Mark 10 and 13 says this. And they brought the young children to Jesus that he should touch them. And his disciples rebuked the children and told the children, get away from here. But when Jesus saw and heard what was going on, he was upset. And he said unto them, suffer the little children to come unto me, and forbid them not. For such is the kingdom of God. I'm going to translate this. For verily I say unto you, whosoever shall receive the kingdom of God as a little child, he shall enter into the gates of heaven. All right, let me translate all that. Jesus was walking. And at this time, Jesus was like a rock star. My kids love Beyonce. So Jesus was like Beyonce or Michael Jackson. He was walking and people were going, oh my God, it's Jesus. Everybody was freaking out. And the little children wanted to see Jesus. So they just wanted to go up and touch him. But Jesus had a group of his boys called disciples. And they said, them kids coming to Jesus, they're like, get out of here. And Jesus was upset because he wanted the children to come close to him. Now, the reason why he wanted the children to come close to him is because children, unlike us, are pure. See, you and I are tainted. You and I know what Pornhub is. Ain't a virgin in this room, maybe one, amen, praise the Lord. But most of us in this room have been touched by something. Most of us in this room done smoked a little something, done drank a little something, done humped on a little something. Most of us in this room is sinners. Oh, I forgot, two virgins, amen, my bad. All right, so most of us in this room are sinners. But the children are pure. And Jesus wanted the children to come close to him. And he said this. He says, if you want to get into the kingdom of heaven, you have to be just like a child. And when I first read that, I was like, oh, that's weird. So I got to be like a kid to go to heaven? What does that mean to be like a kid? Here's what it means. How many of you have ever been to Disneyland? Raise your hand, been to Disneyland. Or Magic Mountain, or Knott's Berry Farm. Amen. All right, most of y'all been all over. You got very privileged children, rich kids. All right. I grew up on a farm in Arkadelphia, Arkansas, a little town in the middle of nowhere. Long story short, up until the age of 8, I had never been anywhere. I want you to imagine that. Up until the age of 8, I had never left the farm. I hadn't gone to a beach, because there ain't no beaches down south. I hadn't gone really to the park. I hadn't gone anywhere. And one summer, my uncle had promised me that we could go to a water park. Now, this is a little kid who had never gone anyplace. And I saw these commercials on TV, it was a water park, and you saw little white kids sliding around. This was back in the 70s. Little white kids, there wasn't no black kids doing that. Little white kids all over, and they looked so happy. So when I saw this commercial, I said, oh my God, we're going to the water park. I was so excited. I got up at 5 a.m. I was packed and sitting on the stairs at 6 a.m. waiting for my uncle to come so we could go to the water park. I sat there for 10 hours. He never came. I'm 51 years old, and that still bothers me. So when Jesus said that when he wants the little children to come close to him, he wants that same energy that a little child has, that enthusiasm. I was so excited. Imagine a kid sitting outside at 6 a.m. and sit for 10 hours to wait for somebody who never came. Jesus wants that kind of love in order for you to get to the gates of heaven. He says you have to have the eyes of a child. You have to look at me just like a child. You have to love me just like a child, with excitement, with enthusiasm. Because if you ever disappoint a child, he'll never forgive you. He'll remember it to his dying day. I'm 51 years old. I can still remember that day. I forget everything. So the point is, Jesus said, if you want to go to heaven, you have to exert the same energy as a child. You have to look at God with loving eyes and energy and excitement. It's interesting. I call people and I say, you know what, you want to come to church? And most people, oh, church, church, Imagine this. You say, coming to church, but then you're going to ask Jesus, can I come to heaven, Lord? Lord, can I come to heaven? He's going to be like, back up, It was coming to church. Why you want to come to heaven now? See, y'all don't understand. He said the only way you get into heaven is if you want to get into church and you want to get into the Word. Because it's the same thing. I don't know why people think we're going to heaven to go crip walk and drink and smoke weed all day. I don't know where we got that from. It's the gangster for heaven. I don't know, heaven for a gangster or whatever. That ain't in the Bible. Amen. If you going to heaven, you're going to do the same thing you do here. You're going to give God praise, and you're going to love each other. You're going to be kind to each other. Ain't going to be a whole bunch of drinking and smoking and having sex all over the place. So the thing is, if you think that's what heaven is, you ain't going anyway. So God said, if you want to go to heaven, you have to do the same thing that we do here. Read the Word, be excited about coming to church, and then treat each other the way you want to be treated. Jesus says, if we learn how to treat each other the way that you want to be treated, he says, you go to heaven automatically. What we do is we treat people how we feel like treating them. We treat people according to our emotions. And Jesus says, don't treat people according to how you feel right now and your sensitive emotions. He says, treat people how you want to be treated. Would you want somebody to treat you the way that you treat them? Be kind to strangers. Be even more kind to your loved ones. And remember, who hurts you the most? The people that are closest to you. It's often the people that are closest to you that cut you the most. It's often the father that touches the child and messes them up for life. It's often the mother who curses a daughter and calls her beads and holes that scar her soul. Be careful how you treat your loved ones. And for you young adults, because you're going to be mothers, we got a couple mothers coming up. Never curse your children. Never curse your children. Because if you cuss at your child, you lower their self-esteem. And they carry that. And men, we carry it different. We carry it, and we carry this anger. That's why you get these brothers get mad. They'll knock a woman out. Because they've been called names their whole life. And now they've embodied that thing, and it comes out as anger. Never curse a child. Never curse a child. Never curse a child. And the last thing. Turn to Mark 8:35. This is just a little bonus. Mark 8:35. It says, for whosoever will save his life will lose it. But whosoever shall lose his life for my sake in the gospels and the same shall save it. Alright, then it says, for what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole wide world and lose his soul? Verse 37, or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Steve Jobs died with $66 billion in the bank. The Chadwick Boseman died with $35 million in the bank. We've been sold a bill of goods. We've been sold that you come to this life and you get as much as you can, and then that's it. But the Bible says this, what is more valuable than your soul? There's a movie on Disney called Soul. And it's a good movie because it talks about the soul. See, the soul is the real you. This is a machine, and it's going to die one day. But your soul lives forever. And it will live forever either in heaven or in hell. What does it profit a man to gain riches and to lose his soul? You do not ever want to jeopardize your soul. Don't you trade anything for your soul. Don't you trade money for your soul. Don't you trade sex for your soul. Don't you trade jobs. Don't trade anything for your soul. It's your soul. You can never get another one. And if you lose your soul, that's it. That's it. And the very last thing, turn to John 8:44. I'm going to leave you a little bit of something to think about. John 8:44 says this, ye are of your father the devil, and the lust of your father ye will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie. And when he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar, and the father of all lies. And then Jesus says in verse 45, and because I tell you the truth, you believe me not. Truth. Satan lies so much that when people tell you the truth, it sounds like a lie. Satan lies so much that when people tell you the truth, it sounds like a lie. If I told you that you had a 99% chance of living through COVID, you would think I was a liar. Because every time you turn on the TV,
everybody dead. The hospitals are full. Everybody dead.
I'm like, where are the dead people at? I don't get dead. But if I tell you this, it sounds like a lie. Because Satan lies so much that you don't even know what's true anymore. All right, next. Turn with me to Revelation, the last thing. This is the last thing. We're going.
You keep saying the last thing.
You better get this word. Turn to Revelation. Revelation 13 and 16. Before we read this, remember that Satan is a liar. Remember this. All right, Revelation 13 and 16. It says this. And he, being the Antichrist, will cause all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive the mark of the beast on their right hand or in their foreheads. Verse 17. And no one can get a job for even buying anything in the store without the mark of the beast, which is permitted by the creature with the code of his number on his name, barcode. Here is the puzzle that calls for careful thought to solve it. Let those who are able to interpret this code, for the numerical values of the letters of his name, add to 6, 6, and 6. All right, this is talking about the mark of the beast. This is an interesting time. It's talking about a time in life where we will be forced to receive a mark. Next, go with me to Revelation 14. We'll be done. Revelation 14 and 9. Then the third angel followed them, shouting, anyone worshiping the creature of the sea and his statue and accepting the mark on his forehead or his hand must drink of the wine of the anger of God. It is poured out undiluted into God's cup of wrath, and they shall be tormented in hell's fire and burning sulfur in the presence of the holy angels and the Lamb. The smoke of their torture shall rise forever and ever. They will have no relief day or night, for they have worshipped the creature and his statue and have been tattooed with the code of his name. Let this encourage God's people to endure patiently every trial and persecution, for they are all saints who remain firm to the end in obedience to the commands and trust of Jesus Christ. Everybody stand. Come up to the front. Everybody stand. Grab my hand. Amen. Everybody stand. Amen. Let's give God a hand clap. Hallelujah! Now, we are embarking upon some serious times. There may come a time in the near future
where we may be forced to get a shot or a vaccination or whatever they want to call it. Personally, I am afraid of that. And the reason why, because it mimics what the Bible says. There will come a time where they will force you. It speaks of a time. So the thing is, but the other side of this, if this is that, and this is the time, and you get whatever they give, then you're gambling with your soul. And it's interesting, Jada just came from Vegas, and Vegas is an interesting place. Las Vegas was not built on winners. 90% of the time when you gamble, you lose. 90% of the time when you gamble, you lose. So I don't know what this vaccination is or this shot is, but I would not risk my soul gambling on it. And somebody asked me, well, Jesus don't understand. Didn't say that in the book. What? It's not our fault. Didn't say that in the book. It said, what does it profit a man to gain the whole wide world and to lose his soul? It says, the man who tried to save his life will lose it. I would rather die being right with God than live to be right with man. Because man ain't got no heaven or hell to put you into. It's funny, because I do funerals. I did a funeral a couple months ago. I do funerals. So they call me. When the body dead, I got to stand over the body. And then, ashes to ashes, dust to dust. Nobody wants to hear Johnny's in hell. They always say, Mama got wings. They always tell me that. I don't ever do that at a funeral. Because if they didn't live according to what God say, I just say, praise the Lord. All right, good luck. I'm not going to lie. I'm a lie coach. God ain't going to give me for that. I remember I did my second funeral, and an old man, he sat in the back. Old man, I ain't never seen him. He was a mortician. So, mortician. That's all he do is funerals. When the funeral was over and everybody left the ceremony, he came up to me and he said, young man, come here, young man. He's about 85. And I was like 50, 45. He said, young man. I said, yes, sir. He said, that was a great sermon you did, young man. And he says, you didn't lie. He says, because pastors get up here all the time and they say, Mama got her wings and she's looking down on you. That's all a lie. It makes you feel good, but it's not the truth. Because you go to heaven or hell, not based on when you die, but based on how you live. So that's why I tell you young people, put God first. Guess what? You have flaws. You're all sinners. I sin. I'll sin all y'all every day. But what is God looking at? He's looking at your heart. See, God ain't going to look at your sins. He's looking at your heart. And if your heart is right, then God will overlook some of your sins. He will give you grace for things that you can't control. That's why the Bible says, seek him first. Try to do your best. And even when you mess up, if God knows your heart and you're his friend, he'll make amends for you. But if he doesn't know you, because you don't spend time with him, he'll say, depart from me, I know you not. And you do not want to hear those three words. So, for this year, 2021, read your Bibles as often as you can. Even if you don't have time, just read the sentence in closing and go about your business. Read your Bible. Get closer to God. Number two, come to church as often as you can. Get closer to God. God takes attendance. And number three, treat each other how you want to be treated. Be kind to each other. Speak encouraging words to each other. Don't talk about each other and gossip about each other and tear each other down, because you guys are in the kingdom of heaven. God is looking at how you treat each other. Be good to each other. And sometimes you mad at somebody. You want to cuss somebody out. I understand that. But after you get through cussing, I'm sorry, make up. Never be ashamed to say you're sorry. Put your pride down sometimes. And I'm the biggest one. So I got to go back. I had to apologize to a girl today, but I was acting up yesterday at the dentist's office. I was just acting ignorant. I was so mad. They told me to put a mask on. Y'all know
mad. I'm like, man, I'm gonna get a million. I just was acting a fool yesterday. And I had to call the girl today. And I said, I'm so sorry. I apologize. Don't be afraid to apologize. Don't have so much pride that you can't, because we're all guilty. We all trespass. We all hurt each other sometimes. That's human. Don't be afraid to say I'm sorry. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Anybody have any words? Can we close this day up? Thank you, man. Anybody have any words? Any questions?
Should I take the shot?
I found this out from one of my friends who's a doctor. If you want an excuse for not taking the shot, they said if you have allergic reactions, you don't have to take it. That's called a loophole. That means if you get a fever or a bump, or if you go, ouch, that's an allergic reaction. Ouch, ooh, that's a, now y'all better listen to this. This is called a loophole. You better get this down. Why can't you not take a shot? I have allergic reactions. So you better learn that good story right now. I have allergic reactions. I'm scared of needles, amen. It's interesting. It was a man, his name was Al Capone, y'all might have heard of him. Al Capone was the biggest and most notorious gangster that ever lived. He died of syphilis, not because they didn't have the vaccine, because he was afraid of needles. The biggest, toughest gangster of the 20th century was scared of it. He killed at least 300 people, but he was scared of, if you put a needle in front, he start crying. Al Capone, big thug. That's crazy, so. Anyway, all right, everybody grab a hand. Screw the other. Thank you. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for this bounty of young people, Father. I ask you to continue to strengthen them. Father, we ask that you bless Deke, Father, recover him, Father. Father, be in prayer for Dr. Dre and his family as he's suffering right now, Father. We ask you, Father, that you continue protection, Father, that you shine your light on these young people, Father. Show them the wisdom of thy words, Father. Help them, Father, to seek you first and to bind negative images and energy, Father, that comes with them, Father. Squeeze the hand next to you. I squeeze life into that hand. I squeeze prosperity into that hand. I squeeze vision and purpose into that hand. That these young people come to head and not to tail. That they become victorious and never defeated. And that no weapon formed against them shall prosper. Continue to strengthen them, Father, and bless them, Father, and keep them, Father, even when they can't keep themselves. We ask that in Jesus' name. Amen. Give God a hand clap. Hallelujah. Love somebody.